What's up, everybody? Sorry, be a little echo there. I was just checking my audio level. We're going to do some audiobook recording. I'm getting closer to the deadline, and story's really starting to pick up, so I'll probably be doing this for 45 minutes to an hour. And, yeah, should be really, really good. I'm hoping. Fingers crossed. So, I will say, some of my game streams, I've learned some interesting things about, like, music copyright. So, I've actually, especially doing YouTube, they have stuff that automatically does claims on copyright stuff, and I also understand why a lot of Twitch people don't do VODs, because it's basically very not legal to stream copyrighted stuff without permission. And even with permission, like, you have to appeal it, and it goes through this whole process, and it's a pain. So, good news is I have located a good Spotify, no copyrighted music playlist, or at least ones that allow it for streaming. And so that'll be good. That's provided by No Copyright Sounds. And so I'm going to get their information in my streams, just as a nice, you know, hey, thanks for putting this together. So that whenever I do play music, like during games or whatever, stuff doesn't get taken down. Because pretty much every game that I've had background music going on, it's gotten taken down. Not that I'm trying to monetize it anyway, but I'd still like for people in the U.S. to be able to see it. And with those, they're not able to. A lot of them just don't allow me to monetize. But like Sony in particular blocks it in every country. So it's good to know. I'm going to just give everything a minute to That's funny. So the favorites have all, well, I have a fair amount of Twitter bots following me that give me auto likes. So that's, I don't know actually how to feel about that. Looks like all of the notifications have gone out. Just going to take a peek at the streams to make sure. Going to take a peek at the other streams just to make sure everything looks good. Oh, let me make sure I pull up the chat. Yeah, I feel bad. I actually had somebody message me last night, and I was so wrapped up in raging at Overwatch that I just completely missed them. So if you do send me a chat, I do have the book full screen at the moment, so please be patient with me, because when I do kind of get into recording it, it's kind of all encompassing. I'm just getting chapter 7 data ready. good news is I still have all of my sound settings the same as yesterday, so... So for anybody joining and anybody watching this after the fact, basically, it's probably on me. Basically, I'm an audiobook recorder or performer and audio producer. And so I work with authors and publishers to get their works turned from just regular print books to audiobooks, and then they get published on Audible and on iTunes. And so essentially, yeah, I mean, then we all split the profits. Basically, as far as I'm aware, just as long as it's for sale. So it's really a fantastic gig. I do it because it is just fun and awesome. So, I would most likely do it regardless of pay, but the splits are pretty good. It's all dependent upon what the print rights holder, or sorry, the audio rights holder wants to do. For anybody who wants to get into it, I'd highly recommend checking it out. You just go to acx.com. And, you know, if you like doing any kind of performance or dramatic readings or things like that, it is very, very fun. And so you can be as picky or as non-picky. I just really enjoy the actual recording of the, like, the actual recording process. And so I like the type of book doesn't really matter to me. So anyways, daylight's burning, as they say, so I'm going to go ahead and get started. And, yeah, if anybody does have questions or want to shoot me a message, just please give me a moment to stop once I hear the notification. Actually, I'm going to see if I can turn that up. Hopefully, I hear that. That's kind of soft. But I guess we'll see. So I'm just going to do a quick little audio check here on my recording, even though I haven't changed anything. Test, test. Chapter 7. April 28th, 1891. Talbot House, evening. Test, test. Chapter 7. April 28th, 1891. Talbot House, evening. All right, that sounds good. Also, for those who know me, I'm obviously not British, but I do have to do this accent for forming my book. So I will probably be speaking like this for the rest of the time. It's much easier for me to stick to the accent than to switch back and forth. I believe I'm getting a little better about that. However, it's still much too soon and much too difficult, at least for me, to go back to it. And the more I speak in it, the easier it comes. So let me go ahead and just close some of these. Okay. Again, if you have any questions, just put them in the chat. And, yeah, so we're going to go ahead and start. Actually, let me go ahead and log my start time. 53. All right. Chapter 7. April 28th, 1891. Talbot House, evening. A day full of emotions. Oh, dear journal, were you a person, I would feel the need to apologize for forgetting about you today. I use you as a physician, to not say an alienist. I promised myself to pen down everything I experience here so that when I reread it, I can evaluate my state of mind. And what a good commitment is that, for after today's events, I'm more than convinced there's foul play going on among the people. Actually, I just want to start over. Let's go ahead and just do that. Sometimes it is easier just to... if you feel like you just didn't like the read or you didn't like it the way it came, just rereading a passage, sometimes you'll do a different interpretation of it and it'll be fantastic. Chapter 7, April 28th, 1891. Talbot House, evening. A day full of emotions. Oh, dear journal, were you a person, I would feel the need to apologize for forgetting about you today. I use you as a physician, to not say an alienist. I promised myself to pen down everything I experience here so that when I reread it, I can evaluate my state of mind. And what a good commitment is that, for after today's events, I'm more than convinced there's foul play going on among the people of Ballymore. That was much better. Let me go ahead and just listen to that there. Chapter 7, April 28th, 1891. Talbot House, evening. A day full of emotions. Oh, dear journal, were you a person, I would feel the need to apologize for forgetting about you today. I use you as a physician, to not say an alienist. I promised myself to pen down everything I experience here so that when I reread it, I can evaluate my state of mind. And what a good commitment is that, for after today's events, I'm more than convinced there's foul play going on among the people of Ballymore. Good, good, good. All right. Continuing on. The hag attack I suffered last night could be more than a nightmare. Same goes for the other queer occurrences, lest no forget the murder of Squire Douglas. These are dark days here in Ireland. A never-sated need for rebellion against the British crown is coming ablaze again. It grows in the underworld, feeds on the commoner's rage, especially in the countryside, and skulks within unthinkable holes. Laying behind national heritage and tradition, the smoking coals of independence, hidden under the ashes of unionism and the commonwealth, are fast to rekindle and hard to dispel. While I will not discuss the right... Hold on. Some kind of banging. Just a moment.
Sorry about that. mundane nonsense, I'm sure. But I do have a turkey going, or a chicken, rather, going in the rotisserie. And unfortunately, one of the legs came out, and everything in there is about a million degrees. So I just ended up, rather than having to try to retie it, I said the legs come off. The leg came wonky and was kind of just lying around or flying around in there. So rather than stop the whole process and take much longer, I just cut off the leg, the offending leg. And again, sorry about that. The sounds, any extraneous noise does have an effect on the recording. I don't think I quite heard it in the audio, but I'm going to check. The smoking coals of independence, hidden under the ashes of unionism and the commonwealth, are fast to rekindle and hard to dispel. I think I caught it pretty quick, because that was rather loud. While I will not discuss the right, or not, for an independent Ireland, I strongly condemn the nefarious manipulation of superstitious villagers to trigger an uprising, for I'm sure a conspiracy is underway in the Glencree Valley. How I came to this conclusion? Simple. By the application of logic and rationalization. Rationalization. How I came... How I came to this conclusion? Simple. By the application of logic and rationalization. It comes a moment when a man must step out of the circle of darkness he fell into, climb the tallest hill, and, once at the top, look down with a brand new perspective. The top, look down with a brand new perspective. And this new perspective I gained by looking at history. Since 1874, agricultural prices have been dropping in Europe, followed by some bad harvests due to wet weather. This has been having a strong negative effect on many Irish farmers, who found themselves unable to pay the rents they had agreed on, particularly in the poor and wetter areas. It was out of this desperation that the Irish National Land League was born, and that led to the Land War. This war was fought in the countryside from 1879 to 1882 in pursuance of the three Fs, fair rent, fixity of tenure, and free sale. The League organized resistance to evictions and reductions in rents. Landlords' attempts to evict tenants led, naturally, to violence. When Ashburn's Act in 1885 made evicting tenants unprofitable for most landlords, this violence was supposed to end, yet tenants found that holding out communally was the best option. Oops. Bugger me. Sorry, I thought I heard something. Upheavals continued. Accompanied by several years of bad weather and poor harvest, the agitations and subsequent evictions led to a rent strike. Although the League nominally discouraged violence, agrarian crimes increased widely. The rent strike was followed by eviction by police officers and bailiffs. The tenants who had continued to pay the rent were subject to boycott by local League members. This created a great divide among farmers. Political elements have easily infiltrated this strife, and now, after the Land League is officially suppressed by the authorities, they have broadened the issue to home rule. A renewed land war is going on, yet this time it is more subtle, and its covenanters are using national pride and tradition for their own means. Anarchists, independentists, and ruffians of all sorts are joining this hidden game. In my case, there's a supernatural smokescreen set around me and the good folk of Ballymore. After today's events and encounters, I will be more careful about my acquaintances and I will not allow my goodwill to cloud my eyes. At the moment, I'm not in physical danger, for whoever is behind this plot to scare me out to Talbot House has showed no intent to kill me. No, they just want to frighten the... Oops. No. No. No, they just want to frighten the meddling fauna away, and I don't like it. More, I have found a new resolve in my affection for Maggie Blair. Let's start in order. This morning, sweet Maggie came alone. She said Siobhan had gone to greet a tribe of blood relative gypsies who had just set up camp at Lubraid Lower. Well, that's not bad. Sometimes in my head or in my mouth, I feel like I've said something incorrectly, but when I re-listen to it, it sounds fine. These aren't travelers, but true Romani, a compagna, or company, of Czech families led by a matriarch. Maggie said it was great news. Lower. These aren't travelers, but true Romani, a compagna, or company, of Czech families led by a matriarch. I'm going to double check my pronunciation. I'm pretty sure that is correct, but... Zek. Zek? Did I say it like it was Z? I think it did. Families led by a matriarch. A compagna, or company, of Zek families led by a matriarch. Zek. Maggie said Zek. It was a great... That's not bad. It's relatively close, but... These aren't travelers, but true Romani. And while I'm at it, I may as well... Compagna. Compagnia. Compagnia. How to pronounce Compagnia?
Compagnia.
I hate the robot ones. They just...
Compagna.
A compagna or compagna. All right, that's fine. Bugger. Okay, go back. Thank goodness he doesn't use the same words. Well. The same collections of words too many times. That would be difficult. A compagnia, or company, of Czech families led by a matriarch. Maggie said it was great news, as this compagnia's goal is to restore the diminishing mana, the world's inherent magical energy, into the fairy stones. She appeared excited and was like a stream of awakening in springtime, when the waters, frozen by winter, happily burst out of the thawing. Without doubt, she lifted my sullied humor. She spoke of portents, fairy forts, and wondrous places, and I, while looking at her, could not avoid being charmed by her mirth. "They are going to restore the land, sir," she said, pirouetting, her red skirt lifting so high it exposed her beautiful calves. My eyes widened at the sight, and she must have noticed, for soon she calmed down, then, bowing, apologized for her excesses. I smiled and reassured her that she had not offended me. On the contrary, I was in need of some good spirit. Also, an idea occurred to me. "It is such a wonderful day, isn't it?" I said, peeking out of the window. The morning sun was painting the hills in magnificent gold and vibrant green. "It surely is, sir," she concurred as she came to my side. "Are you going out again?" "No," I said, looking at her. "We are going out." I took her hands. "The house doesn't need your attention today, but I do." Perhaps I showed too much audacity, for immediately she blushed and her eyes fell to the... "The house doesn't need your attention today, but I do." Perhaps I showed too much audacity, for immediately she blushed and her eyes fell to the floor. Still, she didn't retract from my hands. Moreover, I need your opinion on something. I discovered yesterday... There definitely is not a period there. Moreover, I need your opinion on something I discovered yesterday. It's hard to describe, and I think it's better you see it with your... It's hard to describe, and I think it's better you see it with your own eyes. She lifted her head. What is it, sir?
Let's
do a bit of Tenet right there. Well, it's actually more than one thing. There's a hole just on the other side of the hillock. But the most peculiar thing is this stone slab I found inside the cave. Have you ever heard of that? Maggie looked out with a puzzled expression, then her fine lineaments twisted in the grin of a child trying to remember a poem learned at school. A shadow crossed her face before she shook her head.
No, sir, sorry.
Does that mean you're not coming? Maggie smiled.
No, I mean I know nothing of that place. I've heard stories about a witch living in a hole in the distant past, but I've never seen that place.
Then she immediately added, and yes, I'm coming with you. Oh, if I had known in what sort of additional worries I was putting myself, I would have surely shelved the idea. I should have listened to the symptoms of my fact-racing heart. I should have listened to the symptoms of my fast-racing heart, of the excitation at the
of the excitation of the excitation at the idea of spending my day out with her. But I didn't, and by consequence, I'm in trouble. I decided it would be better if we circled the hillock with the trap, so that if we found something inside the hole, it would be easier to transport it back home. Also, I could use Bertha's strength to uncork the stone from the earth. Later, we would continue for the toppled stone, and by afternoon we would reach Ballymore, just in time for a tea with Father Wales. He still owed me the story of St. Kevin and the slab. So, while I fastened Bertha to the cart and loaded the necessary tools, Maggie took care of preparing the necessary for a picnic. Before going, I had breakfast with Maggie, who, though shy to share the table with me at first, ended up enjoying my company. The food was delicious, the conversation even more. Maggie asked to know more of me, my family, how life was in America, and about my past. I answered each question sincerely until it was my turn to know more of her story. And what a story it is. Maggie Blair wasn't born a traveler, or, more aptly, she was born half-blood. Her father was Lazaro Strazzi. Lazaro Strazzi. Rovers Carnival Strazzi. Her father was Lazaro. Her father was Lazaro Strazzi, also known as the Fabulous Lazaros, a knife thrower at the Rovers Carnival. Her mother was Milena, daughter of Siobhan. While attending a fair in Dublin, Milena fell in love with the dashing Lazaros. He was, it seems, a charming man, renowned for his throwing skills and his silver tongue. Siobhan disliked him, being a gage. Oh, another Gaelic term. Let's look that up, because it's almost never actually as I think it goes. By almost never, it's probably 60-40. I get it right versus not. Well, that's giving me a lot of credit. Pronunciation. Oh, of course. It's one of the first things there. Oh.
Gaze.
Oh, that's not right. No, I didn't.
Gage.
Robots pronouncing things. How to pronounce it? Go. Ain. Gage. Okay. Gage. How did I say? I'm curious. Siobhan disliked him, being a gage. That's not close. That's not even a little bit close. Oh my. Interesting. Let's check this out. Gage. G as in go. AI, A as in pain, J as in jug, gauge. Fair enough. Let's check this out. Oh, I think I've buggered up on this. Yep, there we go. Just a moment, I need to actually update my stuff on Beam. So I'll actually show up correctly. There we go. do. Curious how I show up here. Music. Seriously? Why? Okay, bugger. All right, let's do this here. Oh, yes, of course. Uh-oh. And Optimax Publishing. There we go. And I'm producing. Yes, so save changes. It's definitely not Overwatch and Chill. Let's refresh it because, well, of course, it's having issues. Let's go back to browse. Fair, fair. All right. Got that straightened out. Sorry about that. We're probably going to go for just a little bit longer. Once the kids and my wife start to wake up, of course, that'll be difficult to do some recording. Plus, it'll be time for family time. But again, anybody watching, you know, feel free to ask questions, say hi. Love interacting. You know, definitely. Definitely just love just streaming and all the fun that comes with that. So do not hesitate to say hello. Right. Shivorn disliked him. And the continue. Shivorn disliked him for being a gauge, not of the blood. Gypsies value their bloodline. They believe they must maintain purity in their race in order to keep the gift of the sight, especially the women. However, so strong was the attraction of Milena for Lazarus that she had a fight with her mother, left her Campania, and joined the Strazi as her assistant. Joined Strazi. Not the Strozzi. And joined Strozzi as her assistant. Maggie was born out of that love, and she lived with her parents up to the age of 9. Then, tragedy struck. Milena doubled as a fortune teller at the traveling show. Wearing flamboyant and revealing clothes, She lured clients to a tent where she predicted their future. Though she had no true sight, according to Maggie, she was skilled at the scam called bujo, or swindle. I'm from the south, so I'm more apt to pronounce things that way. Of course it's not. I'm going to have to go with my gut on that one. The other one, the J, was a J, so Bujo or Swindle.
Bujo, or swindle. Let's go ahead and mix and render the tracks. Takes just a little bit. In this scheme, a gypsy woman looks for a likely, read, gullible or desperate, victim to con. She uses sleight of hand to replace one of the tarot cards she was reading for her client with a scorched version of the same card. Then she cries out and acts worried. When the target of this scam demands to know what's wrong, the fortune teller tells the client that the news is not good, but perhaps she's wrong. At the client's insistence, the prognosticator will reveal that she sees terrible luck befalling the client. Then, she explains that the possible source of this misfortune could be some cursed money. Then, I don't like that read. Then, she cries. Then she explains. Terrible luck befalling the client. Then she cried. Client. No. Boom. Boom. Then she explains that the possible source of this misfortune could be some cursed money. Thus, she will hastily return any money the customer has paid for her services as she doesn't want to be contaminated as well. After a bit of talk, she will ask. After a bit of talk, she will ask the person to give her some small notes or coins so she may determine if the money is indeed cursed. Want to be contaminated as well. After a bit of talk, she will ask the person to give her some small notes or coins so she may determine if the money is indeed cursed. Want to be contaminated as well. After a bit of talk, she will ask the person to give her some small notes or coins so she may determine if the money is indeed cursed. Naturally, she will find out so. And, of course, she can remove the curse. The hitch is that all the client's money has probably been infected by the curse, and so the victim should bring the gypsy a suitcase filled with money. In order to undo the curse, some of the money must be destroyed. Once the client has brought as much money as the fortune teller can convince them to bring, she performs a great ritual that ends in the burning of much of the tainted money. Obviously, the money will not be destroyed, for at the first opportunity, the con artist will switch the bag full of money with one containing papers. However, sometimes the scam turns on the scammer. Lazarus had always been a jealous and possessive man. He regarded Milena Blair as property, and had more than one fight with other artists at the carnival when he spotted a gaze lingering for too long on his wife's graces. There were rumors that he had killed a roustabout when he overheard the man complimenting, in a lewd way, Milena's figure, though no proof was ever found. Maggie remembered that when her mother started to work as a fortune teller, her father was always in an ill mood and took every opportunity to wrangle with his wife. Strozzi was a violent man, full of rage and consumed by it. He steamed it off by sharpening his skills at throwing, and by verbally attacking his wife. Milena, however, would not back off. Being an Irish-blooded Rom, she had a fiery temper too. Theirs was a stormy but passionate relationship. When Maggie was 9 of age, the carnival was touring the province of Munster, and it stopped in Crosshaven, a beautiful village overlooking Cork Harbour. Don't want to get going too long on a particular line here, because it looks like Audacity is having an issue. When Maggie was 9 of age, the carnival was touring the province of Munster, and it stopped in Crosshaven, a beautiful village overlooking Cork Harbour. It was in that place that Milena met Arthur Fitzhugh, pretty sure that's how you say it. Let's take a look here.
The following pronunciation is brought.
Don't care.
Fitzhugh.
That's right. Fitzhugh. Of course. A beautiful village overlooking Cork Harbour. It was in that place that Milena met Arthur Fitzhugh, the son of Lord Chesterton of Balcombe, West Sussex. Lord Chesterton and his family were guests of the Earl of Cork, and were enjoying the summertime at Crosshaven. Young Arthur became attracted to the beautiful Milena and started to visit her every evening. Maggie's mother immediately targeted him as the right man for a bujo, for Arthur was as intelligent as a rock. Unfortunately, Lazarus mistook his wife's interest for the young man as something more. He spied on Milena while she received the gentleman in her privy. Upon hearing the stranger complimenting his wife, he became scarlet with rage. However, what sent him beyond the edge was the bag of money. Believing it to be payment for Milena's favors, he went mad. That night became the Strutsies and the Rovers Carnival's last show. Better I describe what happened by transcribing it the way Maggie told me. The lights
were bright.
It was
in that place.
Oh, bugger. That is the chicken. Fantastic. Does need a little bit of time to rest, so I will take care of that in a minute. All right. Maggie told me. The lights were bright in the big top. The smell of grease paint, candies, and horses assaulted my senses like every time. I loved the circus, but now I can't stand it anymore. I was standing behind the main curtain, the one leading to the ring, close by Mr. Errol Pierce. He was the founder, along with his brothers, of the Rovers Carnival. A portly man with receding ginger hair, Pierce had been like a grandpa to me. He always said that he had great expectations for me, like he knew I was of special blood. Errol spoke high of my real grandma, Siobhan, and how much he missed her. I think he was in love with her. I don't know all the details, as Granny never talks about him,
but I know the two used to be friends before my mother married my father. Aaron was the sole owner of the show after Samuel and Duffy, his brothers, were called in the Lord's embrace, a good man. That night, he spotted a shadow on my face and asked to know why I was frowning. I said I was worried about my parents because they were always fighting. I remember him smiling and grabbing my face with affection. He said I didn't need to worry, for my dad and my mom had always been like the sea, stormy one moment, calm and beautiful another. But I think he just saw the professional side of their relationship, for, you know, even after a bitter fight, my parents were like one when performing in the ring. You could see the trust in my mommy's eyes. You could see the trust in my mommy's eyes as my father threw blade after blade at her on the spinning wheel. But Mr. Pierce hadn't seen my father's face while he was practicing in our tent. Early on, I had stumbled in while he was honing his skills, throwing knives at my mem on the rehearsal board. With them, there is this man, Rudolph, a stage magician. He was one of those kind of men that's not happy unless he has someone to needle, and my dad was one of his favorite targets. So, while he was about to throw the fifth dagger, Rudolph says something I didn't understand at the time, and my father's knife went wild. Luckily, my mom ducked out of the way in a split second and the blade buried itself in the board mere inches from her face. At that, Rudolph blurted that sawing somebody in half was his act, not my dad's. I saw my father's eyes turn dark, and I think Rudolph saw that too, because he excused himself and left the tent. My mam hadn't heard what Rudolph had said, so she asked my father what was wrong. He shook his head and told her to get ready. He shook his head and told her to get ready. The show was about to commence. Then he noticed me. He smiled sadly, caressed my hair, and told me to go to Mr. Pierce. I will never forget his face. Though I can't forgive him for what he did, I have pity for his soul. Caught at the end. During the show, he missed his third throw. The knife sank deep into my mam's heart, killing her on the spot. Later, knowing the facts, I understood what Rudolph had said to my father. Like a whispering imp, he had told him that the young Chesterton was here to see Milena again. And in fact, he was there in the first row. Completely maddened, what was once my father but had now become a murderous monster, threw two daggers at the Lord's son. One missed. The second found its mark into the gentleman's right eye. As you can imagine, the carnival erupted into chaos, police were summoned, and the traveling fair was closed. My father was arrested, but he never reached the prison. My father was arrested, but he never reached the prison. He died of a stroke in the police wagon, so the officer said. I was sent to an orphanage in Dublin, and it was there that my grandmother found me. As of that day, I can't stand fairs and circuses. So the officer said. I was sent to an orphanage in Dublin, and it was there that my grandmother found me. As of that day, I can't stand fairs and circuses.
Oh, bugger. That is awful. Awful. I feel terrible for. It does sound very much like
Batman, you know, Robin. Well, not actually. I realize I may be marshalling the pitchforks against me, but just the terribleness in which they died, especially in the circus, the similarities really end there, but God, that is terrible. I mean, I've read it before, but even rereading it now, it's very tough, very tough. Let's see, how much more do I have in this chapter? So, about page 82. So, one. So, 10 pages. Oh, yeah. 20 more pages, I don't think that's going to work. Or I don't think I will finish it right now. So let's do this. I've been streaming for about... Oh, I don't actually know. Let's see. Again, this is not right. I've been streaming for about an hour. Let's see here. Bugger all. Don't remember how to actually change it. My channel launch later settings, maybe? No. My channel. I wonder if I can't change it. So. Oh. I wish it was not showing Overwatch. That is frustrating. So if I go live. I've gone live. I am live. Oh, there we go. So let's see here. Autos and videos, music. I suppose entertainment is probably just the fantastic. All right, so we'll go for maybe about 15 more minutes. I think that will work best, I believe. Okay.
All right.
What a terrible tale. I saw tears taking shape in her eyes as she recalled that last...
Or not. Maybe I say the right words this time.
Fairs and circuses. What a terrible tale. I saw tears taking shape in her eyes as she recalled the last night she saw her parents. So I decided to shake her out of it by returning to the subject of our waiting adventure. I told her about my plans for the day. Thusly, we circled the house, and when we reached the little drumlin, I pointed it to her. There, can you see the cave? She was still upset by the bad memories, and I regretted inquiring about her past. I jumped down the trap, then looked for two suitable trees to create a high picket line. This is something I learned from a Texan friend. When a horse is tied to a tree for a long time, the surrounding ground is pawed away from the roots. The tree's bark is damaged, and the adjacent ground cover is broken and torn. More, it makes the horse nervous. Horses are relaxed and content when tied to a high line. They seldom pull against the line because there is nothing solid to pull against. With the knot above their heads, even the most skilled horses cannot untie their lead ropes or slip their halters. This high picket line, approximately 7 feet above the ground, must be tightly stretched between two trees. Lead ropes are then tied to the high line at the dropped knots. Maggie, obviously, wondered what I was doing, and I told her that after my bad experience with Bertha and the dogs, I didn't want to take risks. I helped her down the cart, and at that moment, when her body was so close to mine, I lost myself in her perfume. My eyes met hers, and something passed between us. She's the most beautiful woman I have ever seen. Embarrassed by the contact, she gently pushed me away, then went for the lead rope, ready to fasten it to the closest tree. "No, I don't want to tie Bertha that way," I said. Then I explained her my intent. She looked at me quizzically. "Well, you are full of surprises, sir. It would never occur in my mind that a gentleman like you possessed such a wisdom about the wilderness." "Please, Maggie, call me Patrick. I'm no sir," I said while climbing the first tree. Again she blushed but said nothing. She helped me make the high line and watched as I fastened the ends with Dutch's knots. "And about me knowing of the wilds, yes, I know more than I show. Though I'm a city slicker, as my good friend Jim McFarlane likes to remark, I'm not wet behind the ears. To be honest, one of my dreams was to go exploring the West."
"Oh, I've heard about that," she exclaimed.
"Is that due in Edinburgh?" I frowned, trying to understand. Then I remembered. Since 1887, Buffalo Bill's Wild West had become a popular attraction in Europe. A pitiful thing of tame Indians, where even the proud, but now broken, Chief Sitting Bull had performed. "No, not that," I said with disdain. "The real West. What is left of the true frontier?"
"Is it really that wild?"
She moved toward me. I took Bertha's lead from her hand and secured it at the high line. Again, her smell invaded me, transported me. I felt hot.
This will be a quick succession.
In that precise moment, I knew I wanted her. I'm aware there are certain rules against a gentleman...
I'm aware.
I'm aware.
I'm aware...
Oh, bugger. I hate it when I lose my place.
I'm aware there are certain rules a gentleman must abide by, but I can't deny that my thoughts were far from pure. I couldn't remove the vision of her calves from my mind. She was there, swirling in her red skirt, the white blouse revealing too much of her soft skin, the jingling of her wrist bangles, her corvine hair dancing in the air. Bertha interrupted my daydreaming with a snort. Well, I will tell you what I know of the real Wild West once we are finished with this. I pointed to the tools. Please, help me with those. You take care of the lamp. I'll carry the rest. We climbed the hillock until we reached the cavern, and immediately I noticed... Oh my. Screaming with a snort. Screaming with a snort. Well, I will tell you what I know of the real Wild West once we are finished with this. I pointed to the tools. Please, help me with those. You take care of the lamp. I'll carry the rest. We climbed the hillock until we reached the cavern, and immediately I noticed... Screaming with a snort. And immediately I noticed something was wrong, or different. Someone had been there. Footprints of at least 3 men were clearly visible about the entrance. I didn't wait for Maggie, but rushed inside like an idiot. I was concerned about my treasure. Luckily, I found no one, but I found signs of a recent attempt at removing the slab. Someone had dug all around the triangular slate, exposing the thick border. Yet, it was still deeply encased in the ground, sign that the intruders might have been disturbed during their work. Maggie's voice from behind my shoulder startled me. Is that what you were talking about? Not saying a word, I grabbed the lamp from her hand and lit it. Is that what you were talking about? Not saying a word, I grabbed the lamp from her hand and lit it. Under the light, I could confirm my hunch. Those words were written in Latin. They are faded and some letters are scratched. More, on the north side there's a crack, as if some kind of accident happened to the slab in the past, or someone scraped it. I studied Latin at university, as it is good care of a surgeon or a generic practitioner to understand the works of our Greek and Roman predecessors, and I'm sure it reads. Oh, bugger. Oh, Latin. I actually studied Latin a little bit, and most of the pronunciations are similar, at least, to English. Still not... it's not easy, so... Coemgenes glendalocensis... Declarat nemo movere lapidum ne rumper tenebras. Holy moly. I wonder if anybody actually has pronounced that entire thing. Your search did not match any documents. Fantastic. Latin pronunciation. Irish. Let's do English UK.
Coemgeas.
Coemgeas. Coemgeas. Coem.
Coemgenus.
Coemgenus.
English.
Coemgenus. Coamgeus.
Coamgenus.
Oh, bugger. What? Siobhan. Kevin? So that's why it keeps coming up like that. Genus Glendalocensis. Holy moly. Actually, I may be best served by writing this out phonetically, how I'm actually going to say it. So, yeah. So, bomb. With particularly difficult passages, I will actually just write them out phonetically, allowing me to kind of get through them, because I'm not going to take the time to actually learn Latin. I took 2 years of it in school, and I didn't learn it then, so definitely not going to learn it now. Especially because it's not spoken. If it was something else, I mean, even Gaelic, I just need, you know, enough to, it's enough to get through, to muddle through, so... Right. English, UK.
Coamgeus.
Coamgeus. Coamgeus. What? Do I have a Latin? Latin. Of course not. Of course not. I wonder what the Irish... Do they have Irish? No. Coamgeus. No, it doesn't have to be perfect, but, you know... Oh my. All right. Glendalocensis. Declarat. Nemo movere lapidum ne erumpere tenebras. Coam genus Glendalocensis declarat nemo movere lapidum ne erumpere tenebras. Holy moly. And I'm sure it reads. Coam genus Glendalocensis declarat nemo movere lapidum ne erumpere tenebras. Breeds. Coam genus Glendalocensis declarat nemo movere lapidum ne erumpere tenebras. Kevin of Glendalo declares, let no man raise this stone lest he unleash the darkness. Coam Genus was the Latin name of Saint Coam. Saint Kevin, oh my. Coam Genus was the Latin name of Coam Genus was the Latin name of Saint Coamgen, which was anglicized to Kevin. So the priest is right. This slab was posed in the name of Saint Kevin, or better, it was set by the saint himself. Sadly, it doesn't sound like I've found a leprechaun's treasure vault, but whatever it is, it obviously comes with a warning. And it is surely older than the story of Dark Annis, for Saint Kevin lived in County Wicklow in the 6th century. If authentic, that stone must have been placed there around 1,300 years old. Years ago, possibly. Not the author. I read what's on the page. Maggie knelt beside me. She ran her fingers on the letters. That symbol in the center, she murmured. I've seen it before. She touched it, then retreated her hand and screamed as if that flaming eye was the real thing. Immediately, she passed out. Luckily, I was close and grabbed her before she hit the ground. However, the lamp slid off my hand and, after rolling loudly on the floor, died. Alarmed, I gently patted her face. I had no salts with me, and I have no experience on how to revive someone who lost their senses. But of one thing I was sure, better to bring her out of the cavern, as the fresher air and the sunlight might help. I lifted her in my arms and carried her out. In fact, as soon as I stepped into the light, she came about. Dizzy, she murmured something. I didn't feel like putting her down, so I carried her over under the trees where I gently lowered her to the ground. What happened? Oops, nope, that was me. What happened? Are you all right? I asked, while fetching the canteen. She didn't answer, but looked into my eyes. Her pupils were wide and she was shaking. Unexpectedly. Unexpectedly, she threw herself at my neck and then kissed me. At first, I was so stupefied by that reaction that she met only my half-closed lips. Unexpectedly, and then kissed me. At first, I was so stupefied by that reaction that she met only my half-closed lips. But then, overtaken by desire, I responded. I kissed her back, deeply, holding her tight. We forgot about everything. The cavern, the slab, my nightmares. It was just us. I didn't know what had caused that reaction, and honestly, I didn't care. I was so absorbed by that moment, by Maggie's angelic face, her jade eyes, the softness of her porcelain skin, and mostly those lips. Those lips I had desired since the first day I saw her. A mouth made to drive a man crazy. And I indulged on those lips. I ate them like Adam bit the apple, without thinking. She is a traveler. Part of her is Rom. I am a guide, a gauge. I am a gauge. We come from different worlds. Yet, I can't stop thinking about her, even now that she's gone. After that kiss, we stood there in each other's arms, not saying a word. A silent bond was forged from a passionate wind that swept away all the differences in a single but powerful blast. We should go back, she said. We should go back, she said, breaking that silence. Her cheeks were red, her gaze avoiding mine. It was like she had just come out of some sort of spell. We should stay away from that place. What's that? I asked. What happened in that cave? I don't know, she cried. There's something down there. what happened in that cave? I don't know. I don't know. I don't know, she cried. There's something down there. Something horrible. Something buried. I don't know what it is, but for a moment when I touched the stone, I felt something invade in my mind, as if trying to take hold of me. She rose to her feet and started the descent. I ran after her. Tell me, what did you see? She was going fast, and I was worried she could tumble and get hurt. Slow down, Maggie, please. But she wouldn't listen. To the contrary, she lifted her skirt and sprinted down the hill. I quickened my pace, still paying attention to the rocks, and soon reached her. Maggie, I yelled. Calm down. I'm here. Whatever it is. Maggie! Maggie, I yelled. Calm down. I'm here. Whatever it was, it's over. I grabbed her shoulder and turned her towards me. She struggled a bit, but finally gave in. I pulled her into my arms and she allowed me to hold her tight. Then she started to cry. I caressed her hair while her body trembled, consumed by fear. Patrick, she uttered among the sighs, please let's go. I don't want to talk about it. It was horrible. All right, I lifted her chin. Her beautiful face was streaked by tears. We will not talk about it. I just want you to relax. We'll go back home and I'll make you a nice tea. She nodded and started again for the trap. Holding her hand, we went down together. We didn't talk during all the trip back to Talbot House. She just huddled into me, and after a while she fell asleep, as if the emotion, whatever it was, had been so strong that it completely drained her. I can't figure what she must have felt or experienced inside her mind. Maybe, as her grandmother believes, she is a seer, one of those people able to see things that other eyes can't. One of those people able to see things that others' eyes can't, like those that conduct seances and claim to see the dead. Or, maybe, she's just the victim of a plot like me. As I wrote before, today I've collected some, even if circumstantial and purely deductive, proof that a supernatural smokescreen has been set up to scare me away, and to keep the curious far from that cave. But I will write about that later. Okay. Oh. This has been a good stream. Got a lot done. I've gotten almost a half hour of work done. And about 12 more pages recorded, which is awesome. Quickly approaching the 50% part. Now that I've kind of found my voice and found the different characters' voices, I'm not workshopping them anymore. The process does go much quicker. 08. So not bad. Hour and 15 minutes, so 675 minutes. Not a bad time. So, again, a little over halfway, or a little over double the actual time that I'm recording versus what I come up with at the end. It will definitely be a little bit more, considering, I mean, and to be honest, the program I use is called, it's Adobe Audition, to clean it up. Now, I do at some point want to go ahead and start recording with both of those. However, actually, so just at the moment, I don't think that I don't know. At the moment, I don't really want to take the time to kind of just relearn another program. And so, yet again, my stream's not showing up on Beam. It's just mildly frustrating. But anyways, I do hope that you guys have enjoyed this stream.
It's been a lot of fun for me. Again, I do this just for sheer fun and the joy of doing it. So if you guys have any questions, you know, feel free to leave messages. Try to catch me next stream. I know that's not super easy to leave messages on most of the different platforms, but it is quite fun. And, you know, I personally do enjoy it just a lot. So, yeah, so that's about it. So I hope you guys do like this video, subscribe, follow, all that jazz, so that you'll be notified next time I go live. And we've got some cool things coming up. I'm going to be working with Optimus Maximus Publishing to get some more publications, some more stuff going for this. We're going to try to do some little things that are maybe more podcasty type of stuff, like interviews and maybe some giveaways and things like that. But keep looking at my Twitter, at LRavenWolf. I don't have a Facebook page at this time. I'm still debating on whether I'm actually going to do that or not. But, you know, other than that, Twitter is going to be the best way to kind of check on that and follow. At Optimax Publishing is going to be another one. You can see that in the stream title right now. So it's going to be pretty much the best way to, I guess, sort of I guess keep up with things. But for the most part, cool things are coming up. Basically, every person that follows, if you shoot me a message after you follow, or if you follow on the stream, which is pretty much the best way, I will make sure to get you a free copy of one of my current audiobooks. Currently, it's just a kid's book, but if you are like me, it is definitely fun to try to give that a shot. And other than that, though, it's just kind of what it is. So, all right. Well, I'm kind of rambling now, which I always do at the end of streams because I don't know necessarily how to just, I guess, wrap up cleanly. But as I do this more, I will definitely kind of get that going. So, again, thank you so much, everyone, for your support. And I hope to see you soon. Goodbye.